person I once walked into. Involves you, Emily.
Oh my God!
Have you ever caught Jamie masturbating?
Oh my God.
My wildest night out. You don't know this. This is gonna come. So I said, what do you want to do with me? And he said, I want to and lick it all off. Oh. Are we recording?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're recording.
Can I make a point?
Yeah.
Okay. It's just that I was invited to come and do the podcast. Yeah. And I thought, podcast, people listen to podcasts and they're not, so you don't bother with the hair or anything. And then you look and it's all over Instagram with a picture of you with your stomach hanging out and no one's offered me hair and makeup.
Mama, what do you think all the cameras were for?
Yeah.
Well, I thought they were just publicity
they're,
shots.
They're just
something.
For Jack to have at home.
Yeah, Jack plastered it up on beside his bed. Said, there she is. Love her.
There she blows.
Every time you go anywhere, you get hair and makeup. I don't understand.
Not everywhere I go, I get hair and makeup. Not always.
I haven't even put my lip gloss on.
Oh, no. Are you worried about what you're looking like, Mark?
Always.
You look great, though.
Oh, thank you.
Don't worry about it.
I went on the wedding dart.
And you stayed on it?
I've stayed on it now for 8 fecking months.
Wasn't it called COVID at the start?
At the start, it was goat curry in the Yemen. Well, that was easy to give up on. I mean, that was just rank.
Mum said it was wagging its tail, so she couldn't eat it.
You know, it was awful.
Wait, explain this. What do you mean? So this is before the wedding.
Wedding in February, I go on holiday to the Yemen, as you do.
Yeah.
You know, most people go to the Maldives, but no. My husband says we're trekking through the Yemen, where there is a war. Fine. Anyway, it's an island off the Yemen and we're camping with the Sheikh in the hills. Sheikh was born in a cave and he goes, I'm going to honour you and produce a goat, which we're going to slaughter in front of you and make goat curry for your dinner. And the goat is literally going, meh, and its tail's wagging like this. And then they're all going, Allah, and then doing the thing. And then they and I'm like, oh!
In front of you?
In front of us. And Jonathan's all manly about it. And I'm like, oh, God, behind him. And then they produce goat curry. Well, I can't eat that.
It was the same. It was like the time when we were in Kenya.
Oh, God, yeah, I've got photos of this somewhere.
We were in Kenya.
Not with me, with your dad.
No, not with you.
It's because we never went anywhere with you.
We were in Kenya. And it's me, Emily, and Alexander, my brother, and dad. And...
Oh, a family bonding moment.
Yeah. You went there. And
obs.
And anyway, they took us out. The tribe took us out to the fields, and they were said, okay, we're going to go and sacrifice a ram. And we were like, okay, fine, we're going to sacrifice a ram. What we didn't realize is in the Masai Mara, they drink
the blood
from the jugular. So I'm 11 years old. They wrestle this ram to the ground. They wrestle a live ram in front of me to the ground and strangle it. And the ram is, I've never seen anything die. And it's wiggling around like, oh my God. And the ram then finally goes limp and dies in front of me. I'm like, oh my God. They slit its throat.
Yeah.
Use the ram's throat as a bucket and then tell me to drink from it. So I'm like, oh my God.
Just you, not your brother and sister?
Not me.
My brother as well, not you.
No.
My brother as well. I'm like, oh my God. And they say, get in there. So I get in there, I sip this blood from it, and it's like drinking. It's like drinking sort of a hot soup.
Yeah.
Like it's disgusting. And what happened was...
Your teeth are red.
I took the first sip and then vomited into my mouth. So I thought, I don't know what to do here. I can't vomit into the jugular.
Swallowed it.
So I had to swallow a mixture of blood and vomit down in my throat.
You're 11 and they've killed a ram, made you drink it. God, no wonder you're all so bloody traumatised. Wow.
Look, okay, everyone.
I just took you to Portugal and let you get drunk.
We should actually tell that story. What was that story again? What happened there?
In Portugal.
Yeah, what happened in Portugal? So I got to explain what happened.
So summer holidays are long.
Yeah.
And when you live in a 2.5 bedroom house, which we did, which we loved, it was the best house in the world, but it was quite cramped. You can't spend the whole summer holiday there. So I would think, I've got to entertain the kids. So I would take you to Portugal, rent the shittest little villa I could find.
It was lovely.
It was lovely.
See, you didn't mind.
We didn't mind.
It was slightly shit.
By our standards, it was
Yeah, but you didn't go to the supermarket every day, produce the food, get in the car, drive you to the Praka, where God knows what you did. Anyway, finally, I got a new boyfriend, your current stepfather, and he says, well, I'll come with you. And I go, oh, please don't. Please don't, because you have no idea how dreadful this holiday is and you're going to hate it. He goes, no, 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 I really want to come with you and I'll pay for the villa. So I think, oh, hello. Anyway, night one, we get there and I say, well, what we do is we all go out for dinner and it's absolutely lovely. And then we drop the children down at the Praka and they come back when they've had a lovely time partying down there. Mm. 4 o'clock in the morning, Alexander arrives in the bedroom sobbing. Says, Jamie's been taken to hospital having smoked crack cocaine.
No, they thought I had snorted talcum powder or something.
No, snorted crack cocaine.
I'm 14.
He's 14. It's 4 o'clock in the morning and I'm thinking, oh my God. Emily's sweetly asleep in her room.
That's because I wasn't allowed out.
And your stepfather takes control. Uh-huh. He rings security. Down at Val de Lobo, who don't speak much English, but they confirm that a white boy has gone in an ambulance. They have no idea where.
The
Jonathan, I mean, honestly, how Jonathan did this, because I'm lying in bed going, he can rot. Leave him, he can rot there. And Jonathan's ringing every Portuguese hospital in the area, getting in people who don't speak English. And finally, he finds a cleaner in Lule who goes, yeah, much alcohol, English boy. And there you are. And when we get there at 7 o'clock in the morning, we're told to pick you up. You're on a gurney in a corridor, stinking of vomit. And I said to Jonathan, he's going to say his drink was spiked. And Jonathan said, no, he won't. He'll be honest and admit it. You sat up on your gurney and you went, my drink was spiked.
But I think it was spiked.
It wasn't. You drank a bottle of absinthe.
A bottle? Where did you get a bottle of absinthe?
I remember. Do you know what's so funny about this story?
You had Charlie, your friend, with you.
Do you know what's so funny about this story? Is that I drank something called Gold Strike and absinthe, which was a mixture of absinthe and Gold Strike. Gold Strike supposedly had little flakes of gold in it and it would cut your throat to make the alcohol hit your bloodstream quicker. So we were doing this. And the last thing I remember, I'm 14 years old, the last thing I remember is walking across this little thing in Portugal. Last thing I remember, and who was walking towards me? I thought it was Danny from McFly with his hair, but it wasn't. It was Ollie Locke.
No.
That's the last thing I remember. And then I woke up in hospital. That's the last thing
with
I remember.
With me leaning over the gurney.
Yeah, you leaning over the gurney.
Cross.
Look, welcome. I just want to say this. Welcome back to the podcast, my mum and my sister. You ready to enjoy another episode?
Absolutely.
You ready for this, Mama?
Bit of family bonding, really.
Family bonding. We're going to get into it. You ready for this? Hello, everyone. Welcome back to NewlyWeds Podcast. My mum is here, Penny. Hi, Penny.
Hi, darling.
Hello.
Back again.
Back again. And my little sister, Emily. Hello, Emily.
What's up?
We decided to do a family episode today. Sophie is currently away at her sister's wedding.
Or the build-up to her sister's wedding. She's keeping her sister calm.
People are wondering where Sophie is because she's been away sorting out weddings and things like that. And so now I've just got my family on the entire time. You enjoying it?
What fun.
We love it.
We love it. We're not getting out.
After popular demand, Penny's back.
Can't believe it was popular. So indiscreet.
You said to me that you look down the comments because you're worried about the comments are going to be nasty or something like that. And you said you look down the comments to see if there's any nasty comments for me sometimes and you find some.
Yeah, horrid ones about you. Like, really horrid. And then my husband, the current husband that I have, said... Oh, they're going to say the most terrible things. You just look down and they'll say that fat middle-aged woman is on. And I couldn't... And there wasn't...
Middle-aged.
Okay, that fat elderly woman is on. But actually, they were so nice. Thank you, all the listeners. You were so nice. And it really was lovely to read your comments. I really, really appreciated them. Made me very happy.
Did it?
So nice about you.
And not a lot makes me happy these days. But that made me very happy. I read them to the dogs.
We were driving in, Lou, Emmy, and
we were driving in from the country to London, and I was with Mum. And suddenly Mum goes, I need to listen to a podcast. And I was like, okay, you're right. And she goes, just feeling really anxious. And I went, why are you feeling anxious? Because she was worried that we were going to come on the podcast and talk about what a bad mother she was.
Just thought it's going to be, you know, when you said Emily's coming to, I just thought, oh God, it's going to be gang up against me. You're going to say how bad your childhood was.
But it was great. You don't need to worry about that one bit. It was an amazing childhood.
No, so I took you to Portugal and let you run, lose your virginity. And
that's great.
All those things. Do you know, back on Portugal again.
Imagine if you'd never lost it.
I'm actually still a virgin.
You are so not. But do you know the other thing about Portugal?
What?
Was I used to drop you down there at the Praca.
Yeah.
With your friends. Because, you know, I not only took you three on holiday, you all were allowed to bring a friend. Yeah. So I was feeding six children and all on my own.
Yeah.
And when I drop you down there, I go, the one thing you're not to do, promise me, never go on the beach. Do you remember? I used to say you don't go to the beach because bad things happen and you'll get your hand sliced off. And every morning...
What? It's so extreme.
I don't know. But every morning when I picked up your clothes all over the floor, guess what?
Sand.
Pockets full of sand. Mm. You'd been on the bloody beach.
I had.
And I told you not to. What were you doing on the beach?
You were telling us not to go there. Jamie was the one waiting just over the perimeter for people to make a step off. And then he'd go in like a jellyfish. Like an octopus to the face.
We, Emmy, we had a lovely time. Mum and I spent the weekend together because Sophie's away.
Oh, I'm so jealous.
We had such a nice time. But what I realised is it was one of the funniest things that happened. So we, Mum and I would sit down and we'd have dinner together and it was so lovely.
With your stepfather?
With my stepfather, and it would be great. And then obviously we have the two dogs. We have Darcy and Truffle. And Truffle's a boy, Darcy's a girl. And what would happen at the end of, what I've realised, at the end of every, there's a ritual which happens now with the dogs. We finished dinner and Truffle, the male dog, brings in a red towel.
That, I thought that was usually a pre-dinner ritual. Has he changed it up?
Pre and after.
So you know this. So Truffle the dog brings in this red towel via his mouth, obviously, because it's not...
Doing the boxing gloves.
So he brings it by his mouth. And I said to him, I said, what is Truffle doing there? Where's he got this towel? She says, oh God, he wants to shag it. And I went, what do you mean? So then what happens is the dinner's finished. Mum holds up this red towel. She holds up the red towel and Truffle, this dog, humps the towel. Humps the towel. So basically, Mum is giving Truffle a wank.
Listen, Truffle is a true male. He's had his supper before mine. He's eaten. Time for shag. That's what he thinks.
That's why we call it the shag rag. Okay.
But then what happens is Darcy, who's the girl, doesn't know what's
going on. Well, she wants to join in. It looks fun.
So she then grabs it as well.
And she goes twice as fast and hell for leather at it.
How long has that been happening, Mama?
Years.
Emily knows all about it.
Oh, really?
Like it's a ritual. He comes in with his shag rag, and he goes for it. And the thing is, sometimes he gets the right angle, sometimes he doesn't. So sometimes it takes longer than others. But Xander, I remember Xander seeing it happen and going,
this is our brother.
What would you do if I just had a wank? As he said it, Truffle released.
Oh, my God.
Sprayed it like an elephant.
Oh, you're lying. You are lying. You're lying.
He sprayed it. Do you not remember the time that he shagged? He got Darcy in basically a headlock.
This is the other dog.
he took it down to the beach in Portugal as what happened.
You love the dogs more than us.
Oh, more than life. Now, they've replaced you.
They have totally replaced you. You love them more than anything in this world.
But they love me more than you love me.
You cried dropping Truffle off more than you ever cried dropping any of us at morning school.
But I stitched his name tapes on as well.
Did you really?
When he went, I gave him this blanket and a smell of my T-shirt.
Sorry, you're joking.
No, I just dropped him off at the kennels with my T-shirt.
Before you went on holiday?
Yeah, I cried.
Lily.
And she's a real comfort, isn't she? Emily had her appendix out and she just got into bed with her every day.
The shittest month of my life, and I'd just been dumped.
If you get broken up with, it's never that good, is it? You get upset.
I was dumped by everyone. Always
Were
dumped.
You?
Oh, dumped by everyone. dump boat, or else I knew I was going to be dumped. Do you want the best story about being...
Which one is it?
Well, I'm not going to say his name.
Don't
Casey,
say his
listen.
Name. Fine.
Okay, so I'm going out. It's between marriages when I'm having my young time.
Oh, I know exactly who this is. And I know exactly what story this is.
Okay, tell me.
And we're going on holiday to Mustique and it's a week in Mustique that we bought at auction, and eight of us are going, and I'm bringing my toy boy boyfriend.
This is like, he's like 29.
No, he's 31. I'm 32. I'm 42. Anyway, he's very good looking. And such fun and everything else. But he's gone a bit weird. We've been together for a year. So, you sort of think anyway, he said to me, big mistake, could you take my suit to the dry cleaner? See, I'm always being such a good, devoted girlfriend, wife, mother.
Yeah, yeah.
So I take the suit to the cleaner. And of course, because I'm good, I clean out the pockets beforehand. Mm-hmm. And he rode a motorbike, big red motorbike. Anyway, in the pocket was a note, and it said, lovely to see you last night. Can't wait to see you again. Don't forget to bring that big red thing you have between your legs, Emma. I mean, what do you do? We're going to Mustique the next day. So I thought, oh, fuck this. Excuse the language.
What did you do, not going to Mustique?
No, I thought, I'm not going to Mustique like seven and me. I mean, six, you know, me on my own. Be just hideous. So I'll keep my mouth shut.
So you didn't say anything.
I thought, we'll have our 2 week. It was probably a week. Mm-hmm. Week. We'll have our week, 10 days holiday, because I don't want to go on my own.
Yeah.
And then that's it. So on the very last night, dumped him.
What did you say to him?
Wasn't it on the plane back?
Well, it was the night before the plane back. And then we got the plane back. Tricky flight back, really.
What did you do on the flight on the way back?
Well, actually, if you're listening... You, who knew
that. I don't think he's listening.
I don't think he's listening.
I don't think he's listening.
He cried.
Are you kidding? He never misses these things.
he cried all the way back.
He did?
Yeah, he cried. And I said, because it was never going anywhere. Yeah. I knew that. And he wanted children and a future, and I was having a laugh.
We thought it was going somewhere. We thought we were getting a new daddy.
Yeah.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
He was good fun, though. He played with you. He was really good to you lot.
He was great to us.
He had the best life. He went to work all the time, then tipped up with me where he got fed nice food and drink and didn't pay for jack shit. Anyway, I got him, he was drunk, and I got him to admit that he had seen someone else, and then I got the note out and waved it at him. I said, well, that's it. And he said, oh.
Brought it with him.
And then he said, oh, I feel so bad. And I was like, well, that's it. That's
it.
Oh,
my God.
And was that it?
No.
Yeah, exactly. See,
well, it was it. And then he turned a bit nasty. Anyway, he's with her and the whole thing's off. But then...
Emma.
He's Emma.
He's left for Emma.
Emma.
Okay. And actually, I'm feeling quite sad. I was just like, I don't know, a bit sad. Anyway, the next Sunday, there's a knock on the door. And I hope you're not listening, next one on this. And there's his best friend.
What the hell?
You remember the best friend.
Yeah, and so then you...
And he said, well, look, I'll take the kids to play football in the park. Are you cooking Sunday lunch? They all loved a roast chicken and Jaffa cake. There was always Jaffa cakes in the cupboards. They loved that. And
they
so then,
so young.
yeah, exactly.
Cocktail sausages. Lovely. party rings.
Fruit corners. Delicious. Can you make my lunch?
Where was that?
That is amazing. I remember with the second guy, we used to go rollerblading in
Hyde Park.
Yeah,
that was so much fun.
Still to this day, it's the most painful thing that's ever happened to me in my entire life.
What?
It's the most painful thing that ever happened to me.
Rollerblading?
We were rollerblading and this guy said, why don't you try and jump over that cone? There was a little cone in the middle of the road. And I went, and I was on my rollerblades. I went, yeah, sure. So I skipped on it and I went, boop, I jumped over it and my legs did the splits as I landed. And I landed on my bum and it ripped my bum hole.
Wow. I bet you didn't say anything because you were embarrassed.
It somehow acted as like Velcro. Half of my bum stuck to the ground. The
Oh god.
To this day, the most painful thing that's ever happened to me. Oh my god. Hey, listen guys. We, on the podcast, we have done a little competition and the listeners who are listening will know this. We asked people to propose the podcast and we asked someone to do it in the most sort of extravagant, funnest, different way possible.
No such word as funnest.
Okay. And the person who, and so we sent it out there, and whoever won was going to win £1,000.
Ooh.
Why didn't we try that?
I was just thinking, why the hell didn't I enter?
Yeah.
So we have our winner.
Oh, brilliant.
Her name is Emma.
Oh, hello.
Oh my God, she's back.
Yeah. Maybe it is the person.
Oh, Emma.
We have our person, Emma, who I'm going to FaceTime now surprise her and tell her that she has won
£1,000.
£1,000 for doing the best propose the podcast.
Oh my God, that'll make my day.
Does she know
hers?
That she's expecting a call?
She doesn't know, no. So we're going to do it right now.
She could be anywhere.
Here we go. We're going to phone Emma.
Okay.
Hey, listen, Emma, we're just doing the podcast at the moment. And we absolutely loved the way that you proposed the podcast. So we want to thank you for that. And we're going to say that you've won the £1,000.
Thank you so much.
Don't worry about it. How do you feel?
Honestly, I have no idea. No, it's just crazy.
What are you going to spend the money on?
Well, I'm going to university next month.
Okay.
So probably a lot for that.
Do you know what, Emma? I'm going to put out, I thought you were going to be more excited, but that's all right. No, I'm joking.
No, I am.
Oh, you're bros always like, listen, Emma, we're going to leave you there. Thank you so much, and we adore you.
Thank you. Bye.
We'll see you later. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Well, I thought she was going to... I think she really freaked out when she picked up the phone.
She probably thought, who the hell is this?
Who the hell is this guy who's ringing me? No, she picked up and she went...
I think she was absolutely stunned because actually £1,000 when you're going to uni is quite a lot of money, but she sounded like it was a fiver.
It's a hell of a lot of money.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Imagine the books you can buy.
Oh my God, it's unbelievable. Okay, listen, we're going to go into our favourite bit of the podcast, guys, which I like to call listeners' messages. Are you ready for this?
It's yes. It's not those awful things I have to read out.
Yes, it is. Says producer Jack.
No, it's fine. It's absolutely fine. It's going to be completely relaxed. Are you ready for this?
Yes.
It's now time for...
Listeners' messages.
Okay, time for listeners' messages. This is my favourite part, Mama.
Can I have a drink?
Yeah. Oh, God, not another vodka.
Vodka and tonic.
So triggering.
Yeah. She's going to be drunk again. Oh, no, I can hear her drunk.
She's coming down the stairs.
I have never been drunk in your presence. We used to live in the cupboard, that's it. Oh, God, she's coming. Hide. She thinks she's got that young boyfriend again.
Oh, stop.
I'm joking. She's gone mad. Okay, you ready for this, Mama?
Yeah.
Last time you were on, they were quite rude. So this time, they're a bit nicer.
Are they cleaner?
Apparently so. I haven't read them, as always, but I want to say a big thank you to every single person who keeps writing them in.
I agree. Thank you.
Okay, here we go. This is from Anonymous.
Listen, it's always dodgy when it's anonymous.
Okay. You haven't experienced this yet, Emmy, have you?
No, we did one today.
No, but you haven't experienced it with Mum, so here we go.
No, this is lovely. Here we go.
Myself and my girlfriend met at university and have been together now for over 4 years. We met at university, and when that finished, we would go months without seeing each other. When we finally would see each other, we'd spend weeks at each other's parents' houses at a time. It was my turn to visit my girlfriend at her parents' house, and obviously after not seeing her for a long month or two, it didn't take long for nature to take its course.
I think the moment you got through the bloody door.
Sometimes, multiple times a day.
Oh, good for you.
Like truffle.
One fateful day, we had just finished a lovely session and decided to top it off by spending the day at Britain's most scenic beach, Skegness. We had a great time in the arcades and had some fish and chips and decided to head home. On arriving back at her parents', something clearly wasn't right. Nevertheless, I decided I needed a shower, so I headed upstairs, leaving my girlfriend and her parents alone. I got out the shower, got dressed, and headed downstairs to join the party when my girlfriend stopped me in her tracks. She then told me of the horrific incident which occurred whilst we were away. My girlfriend's mum had a new puppy at the time, which was getting very inquisitive. The dog had clearly gone investigating the room I was staying in, more specifically in the bin.
Oh, God, the condom.
The mutt took the used, entirely filled up condoms out of the bin.
All of them.
And continue to run around with the evidence of our sex life dangling out of its mouth, playing some kind of wild, weird game. Whilst the rest of my girlfriend's family chased it around, including her arthritic mum, they finally managed to get the condom back off the dog and disposed of it properly. We then continued to go down and eat dinner with her family. When her dad dropped something on the floor, it was followed up with, quick, get the dog. The dog will put anything in its mouth.
Don't tell me I've got the only dirty one, have
no,
I?
You won't. No,
okay, okay, right. Listeners, this is number three message, yeah, and it's from Lorna.
Okay.
Laura, now Lorna.
Okay.
Hi, Lorna. Lovely to meet you. I was dating this lovely guy and it was time to meet his parents. Ah, we've all been there. A big moment for everyone. I'm sure we can all agree.
Can you remember the first time I brought back to you?
Was it Lucy Jubb?
Yeah, and she...
Was she the first?
I let her stay in my bedroom.
No, no, no. Hermione.
Was it Hermione?
No. Okay. The one you were sharing, which you shouldn't have been sharing, Sarah. DM.
Oh, Sarah, yeah.
Mm. See, I know them all.
Okay, here we go.
I'd done the usual, bought flowers. Yeah. Bloody nice. Don't think any of them bought me flowers. I'd done the usual, bought flowers, offered to wash up, been very polite, and we all got on like a house on fire. It really was a great relief. They had a newborn too, which was so lovely. I held him for some time and even helped put him to sleep in the parents' room, which was very kind. It meant we could have the baby's room for the evening instead of sleeping on the sofas. As the night drew to a close, everyone went to bed and we got onto our blow-up mattress in the baby's room. Things began to obviously, but very quietly, become sexual. Do you think they had a condom? I hope they did. Now, I'm not silent in the best of times, but my BF, who's my BF?
Boyfriend.
Boyfriend.
Oh,
my
boyfriend.
Best friend.
My best friend assured me we were on the other side of the house so we could have sex. Just don't be yelling about it. I don't know if you've ever had sex in someone else's parents' house. Well, I know that my son has had sex in my house and in my bloody bed. But it can be really hot, especially when you've got to do it secretly. After a lot of foreplay, dear God, why do I get these? We have begun having hot, steamy sex. We must have been going for about 10 or 15 minutes. Well, congrats. Before we started hearing footsteps in the corridor, this is the parents arriving saying, are you all right in there? We did the usual stop, but carry on slowly. After the footsteps went away, we kept at it until the footsteps grew louder and louder, till it sounded where someone was deliberately jumping on the ground. This totally killed the mood. I'm not surprised. Like cooey all over again, isn't it? Okay. It totally killed the mood, and it was so odd, we stopped and went to sleep. However, after an hour or so, this was the honeymoon phase, we woke up and started again. And sure enough, after 5 minutes, the footsteps returned. We were like, what the fuck? Until we heard my best friend's dad yell.
No, boyfriend.
BF's dad yell across the hallway, we can hear everything.
Oh my God.
Well, that would be a passion killer, wouldn't it? My
in
heart
the baby's
sunk.
Room.
How could we have been that loud? And we both silently tried to go back to sleep. The next day we woke up, anxiety pumping through my blood. Well, at least it wasn't libido. I turned to the side, blurry-eyed, and to my... oh, my God, this is hilarious. I turned to the side, blurry-eyed, and to my absolute horror, saw a baby monitor placed right next to the bed. With the baby monitor, can you imagine? God, was it a camera as well? Oh my God, what if it was visual? I can't imagine what the foreplay sounded like. I was so ashamed. I bet you crept out the bathroom window. I could barely go downstairs the next day. And when I did, his father couldn't look me in the eye. Quickly went to work on the garden. Probably so excited by you, he couldn't do anything. His mother came up to me with a cup of tea and said we couldn't figure out how to change the volume our end. But don't worry, we took the batteries out in the end. What an understanding mum. A wild, embarrassed... He is my boyfriend to this day. God, that's well done.
That's amazing.
Good story. But you know what? Why didn't they just bang on the door and say, turn the monitor off, we're listening?
Oh, I don't think you can do that. I think you make a lot of footstep noises. So you don't want anyone to... You don't want to ruin it. So you make footstep noises. And then if they don't shut up, you're like, oh God, I got to say something else.
Listen, I once walked into...
Oh,
don't you want this story?
Who is it? Who does it involve? It
involves you, Emily.
Oh my God.
But it's not about sex.
Oh my God.
It's when I walked into our flat in London where you were living.
Oh no.
And in that particular flat, the bathroom was dead ahead of the front door. and you're sitting on the loo with a pregnancy test with some man I've never seen before standing next to you staring at the pregnancy test, which luckily was negative. And the boyfriend said, how lovely to meet you in this rather awkward moment.
And then, and I remember this, and then you went, you look very sanguine.
Did I say, see, I'm so well read. I'm
What's sanguine mean?
Sanguine.
Sanguine.
What does that sanguine mean?
Calm, relaxed, yeah. Wow. Easygoing.
I remember the door was wide open.
Door was wide open. I walked through the front door. There's Emily with the pregnancy test sitting on the loo. So she's obviously peed on it while he's watching.
That was
Do you know,
thing.
If I, my mother would have, oh my God, my mother, I wouldn't have been able to go home again. That would have been it.
Mama, Emmy, that's the end of the listener's message. What do you think?
Oh, I love those messages.
It was really
You've
good.
Got to say a big thank you to everyone who sent them in.
Well done, the great author of Anonymous, and Lara and Lorna.
Yeah, they were great.
And if you want to send in some more listeners' messages, all you got to do is send them to our Instagram at NewlyWeds Podcast, or send us an email, newlyweds@jampopproductions.co.uk. Before we go, we want to launch something we're really excited about. It's called Secrets Hotline. This is where we want the listeners to send in their deepest, their darkest, their most debauched, all the funniest, most ridiculous stories possible. We want you to send in a voicemail, okay? You've got to send it. We have our phone here. You've got to send it into our phone, and the number is in the description below. Of course, they can all stay anonymous. So if you don't want any names out, don't worry about it. But send it into our secrets hotline, and the number is below, and we're going to start playing them out on the next episode. That is the end of listeners' messages. So, Mama, you're on the podcast still. People have been going wild that you're on it.
I know, that's so kind of them.
It's so kind, and people are screaming for us to have a podcast. Oh, they want us to have a podcast. They keep saying that.
Well, I will, but you're going to have to pay me now.
Okay, fine. People say that you're like Sophie. And that actually I've married a mini you.
Oh, that's so good. Well, I love that because I just love Sophie.
Yeah, so it feels like it's like a mini you, apparently.
It's great. It's just family.
It's family. Okay, so Jack, you have a little game that we want to play, right?
We've asked on the stories for all the questions, the unanswered questions from the last time you guys were on the episode together. Mm-hmm. And so the listeners have been sending in their questions. Okay, this is from Izzy.
Okay, here we go.
The worst story about Jamie bringing girls back, please.
Oh.
They were always so sweet and very polite because, you know, they were being nice. The worst story was when I always thought Lucy had vomited pink cocktail. I've said that before, but then it turns out it was you and you just blamed it on Lucy. I mean, that's pretty bad.
I'd vomited on the ground, hadn't I?
Yeah.
So I blamed that on my
ex-girlfriend. But it was electric pink and you said Lucy had vomited. I'm poor Lucy. She dumped you anyway, so I don't mind.
This is from Jade. This is directed to you, Penny.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever caught Jamie masturbating?
Oh my God. Oh my
No, God. I would. That would. No, God, I'd back out of the. No, heavens above.
Oh my God.
I've never. No. Oh, that would be just awful, wouldn't it?
Don't even ask the question. That's just no.
No, Jay wanted to know.
No, it's just the dog.
Okay. There has been a few. Have you ever caught Jamie having sex as well? I don't know if that's
no, but I walked into a room and please.
I can't.
There was a point when we were all living in London,
yeah.
And the current husband was the boyfriend with a bit of money. Do you remember?
Yeah.
And we couldn't all fit in our 2.5 bedroom house because he wanted to move in. So he very generously and rather stupidly, we rented the flat above the garage across the road.
Yeah,
and
I
put
remember.
You up there.
Yeah.
And I do remember once, you don't know this. This is gonna come. Walking in one morning at about 11:30 because you were asleep.
Yeah.
And it was really hot up there. Do you remember that really hot little flat?
Yeah.
And I expected to go up and find just you asleep and wake you up. And I picked my way through the sitting room over about 7 sleeping bodies of
really?
Boys. Yeah. All your friends into the bedroom to wake you up. And there were you and Lucy, stark naked on the bed. And looking rather beautiful, actually, I thought.
Oh, that's quite sweet.
Yeah.
That's quite sweet.
And you looked rather sort of beautiful and so young.
That's a sweet story.
Mm.
Oh, that's lovely. I like that.
Yeah. So you may have had sex. I don't know. I didn't catch
having
sex.
It was just probably roasting hot in the room.
Yeah, and you were just all young. You always had beautiful skin, you did. You had the best skin ever. I used to like stroking your skin.
Okay, next question.
What was Penny's wildest night out? That's from Kirsty.
My wildest night out. Oh, it has to be. It has to be newly left, very thin, crying. I'm sure I've told this story.
You haven't said the story, no.
I have.
You haven't?
Well, Emily knows this story.
Oh,
I take you to Club Med.
Okay.
On holiday. And I go with my best friend, George, my gay friend, George.
Yeah.
He's helping me out, three kids. And the Irish guy comes up to me and says, do you want to sleep with me? And I go, what? And George is in my ear going, oh, my God. Anyway, I say to him, Jason, how old do you think I am? And he says, I think you're 40. And George in my ear goes, he's trying to flatter you, don't answer. And I said, Jason, how old are you? And he said, I'm 25. So I said, what do you want to do with me? And he said, I want to cover you with yogurt and lick it all off. And I was so excited by that. I said to him, I am not going to sleep with you, but I would kiss you. And he said, meet me down the kayaks. How exciting was that? Meet me down the kayaks. Always thought I'd write a book and call it Meet Me Down the Kayaks. Jason, 25, I'm 42. Ugh. Oh, that was my most exciting
did
night.
Did you meet
ever.
Him down the kayaks?
Yeah, but you know
oh,
what?
Oh, God.
I did go meet him. You want to hear this? I did go, because George said, I'll watch the kids. I've got three children. They're quite small. George says, leave me with kids. And I said, well, I've got to look nonchalant, haven't you? You've got to look kind of, you know, like you're not trying to get down the kayaks. So
you have to act aloof if
yes,
you're walking down
like I just happened to stroll past the kayaks.
Oh, it might as well be.
So yeah. I've got a bottle of fizzy water and a fag in one hand and I'm trying to look like, and I go, oh, good God, Jason, here you are at the kayaks. I was rather amazed that he was there.
He's 25. He probably ran there.
I can't believe my bloody luck. I think, well, eat this, Dad.
That is fantastic.
Most exciting. Anyway, that was it. Kissed him down the kayaks.
Yeah.
Actually, it carries on. It's quite funny.
God. Okay.
Because
okay.
When I get home back to England,
yeah.
I say to George on the plane, well, why didn't I just do it? Get me over the hump, you know?
Yeah.
I should have just done it. No one would have known except you, George. And then I get home and about 2 weeks later, there's a message on my mobile and it goes, hello, Penny, it's Jason. I'm in the Kensington Court Hotel in London. Come and see me. So I ring up George. I say, I'm going to go to London. I'm going to do it. This is it. Get in the car, leave George with the kids again.
Yeah.
Get in the car, drive to London, halfway up, because with no mobile service. Bing! And it goes, hi, Penny, it's Jason. Kensington Court Hotel is full, so I've gone back to Ireland. See ya. Missed it. Never got to sleep with Jason.
Well, if he's listening.
If he's listening, meet mommy down
no,
the
kayak. No, now, listen, now he's probably 60 and I'm, oh, God. Jason,
that is so
most
good.
Exciting night of my whole life.
I love that.
All right, last one.
Yeah.
From Jason.
No, from Jason.
No, I've just made it up.
Oh, okay.
Did you prefer Jamie before or after the Botox?
Oh, before.
I don't have Botox.
Well, why doesn't your forehead move?
It does move. What are you talking about?
I asked him on the way up, we're driving up 2.5 hours from the country, come to the podcast, how his teeth were so white.
Yeah.
So I really want white teeth, and he's got white teeth. I know, I loved Jamie when he was a little boy. He was so loving. If you needed a hug or a cuddle, that was Jamie.
Yeah.
And that soft skin, I used to stroke your stomach.
So
do you remember?
Yes.
And you loved me more than anyone in the world.
Until now, our nanny came along, then I didn't
know. No, you loved
always
me. You always loved me more than anyone in the world. Now I have the dogs because you don't love me more than, you love Sophie more than anyone in the world,
well,
which is right.
Two people I love.
Yeah, but you have to love Sophie much more. And
oh,
you
really?
Do. Yeah, you do.
So if I had to choose between pushing you or Sophie in front of a truck?
I think I'd be under it in a second.
Really?
Yeah.
What about if you were going to push me or Truffle or Darcy under the truck?
I'm afraid the dogs, because you can always... Truffle's got a puppy. I'll go and get one of his puppies. I couldn't push you under a truck.
No,
you're
I
mine.
Know you didn't.
Do you know, when you were young,
yeah.
You used to always do this horrible thing, because I told you about watching this terrible film with Meryl Streep called Sophie's Choice,
yes.
Where she had to give one of her children away.
Yeah.
And you always used to say, so which one would you give? Which one of us would you give away?
Yeah, and which one would you pick?
I'd give you away.
You would not give me away. Yeah. Emily's pointing to herself.
Emily's pointing to herself. Give Emily away.
And Mummy would be like, no, don't take her. Oh, no.
Give Sandra away, because he wouldn't have realised you'd been given away.
Exactly. Jackie, that was great.
So what I've done is I've looked through Jamie's social media and we thought it would be fun if you review some of his most successful posts. We've got videos, we've got tweets ranging back from 2014 to now.
Oh.
Yeah, a real look back at Jamie's social media history. What I'm going to do though is I'm going to get a green screen and put it behind your head so we can put the social video behind you.
Oh, okay.
Hold on. Is that going to be enough?
Yeah,
this is quite clever.
That's me. What is it, Ma? What can you see?
Well, you're naked.
Yeah.
And you've got a suntan because your buttocks are naked and they're paler than the rest of you.
Yeah.
And you've got a flower in your buttock cheeks.
Yeah. What does it say on the bed?
Well, it says at the bottom, liked by Truffle Pig. So that's me. I liked it.
There you go. You liked it. See?
You
liked
it. Do you know what I like about it?
What do you like about it?
You've got longer hair.
Okay, perfect.
So you look so sweet. Oh, there's my boy.
Okay. What's the next one?
2014.
Yeah.
You can wear Gucci in any scenario. Gucci. I couldn't afford Gucci till I got into my 40s. What are you doing at 24 wearing Gucci?
Who paid for that?
You arrogant little twat. You can wear Gucci in any scenario. I just think you were in Gap jeans. Christ. Dear God, this is the book that sank without trace.
What is it?
You're wearing a billboard saying, please buy my book. I can explain. Oh my God, how desperate were we to... He's now reduced to being a billboard boy. Please will someone buy my book. I think the only people that read your book was me and your aunt.
I think so too.
It was such a shit book.
Isn't it good book?
Did anyone buy the Audible?
No,
because you can't
so.
Read, so I can't believe you even got the Audible book right. That is so bad. Okay, next one. Oh no, no, this. Oh no, no. It,
what is it?
You're sticking up wax up your nostrils.
Yeah. Have you ever done that?
Sophie's doing it. Why would you do that?
Have you ever done that before?
No.
Oh my God, it's just the worst.
Why would you do that?
It's horrible.
God, she's cruel. Oh, Sophie. Oh, I can't watch that. Can I move on?
That's you can move on.
That is rank. Oh no, that's awful.
What is it?
You're wearing the worst kind of shiny white Y-fronty things.
Yeah.
Really terrible. Pretending to be David Gandy with your absolute face that you make when you think you look cool and you look stupid. You know that face you do? And you've got a rather stupid necklace on. Actually, it's shit. You look terrible. Okay, this is 2014. And you were pleased with yourself in 2014.
Oh, no. And I've tweeted something more.
I think you're in the way. I will poach her like an egg. What does that mean?
Oh, my God.
Who are you? I will poach her like an egg.
Is that what I've said?
You've obviously, you must think you're the coolest thing that walks the street at this point.
Oh, my God.
I wonder who you were poaching.
Have I actually said that?
Not in my house, I hope not.
Okay, last one, go.
When your puppy finds it. Sophie's got Bobby the puppy with a vibrator with a funny pink thing on it. What's that thing?
Okay, that's enough of that. Whatever, you can put it down. Mama, last time you came on, you gave some great advice. So we thought we'd ask for some more advice again before you go. So last time we asked you about how to make a happy marriage and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But if lots of people listening may be going through breakups and they may be going through heartbreak.
Yeah.
So if someone out there is going through heartbreak or they're going through a breakup or perhaps they want to break up but they don't know how to do it, what do you say to someone about heartbreak?
Oh, heartbreak's the worst. Mm. The worst. I remember breaking up with my boyfriend Mark after 4 years. And in those days you typed on a typewriter, IBM electric typewriter. I was a secretary. I couldn't even press M on the typewriter without crying. And I used to drive around London looking for his car. Oh, God, if I'd had to see him on social media, I'd have probably slit my throat. So that's my advice. If you're dumped,
yeah,
shut down your... Don't look. Don't go there. Don't look. Don't be tempted. Just really, you know, go cold turkey because all it'll do is cause you an agony.
That's so true.
So don't make it worse by searching for him because... He'll be having a good time and it'll just tear your little heart out.
And you always say hope's a killer.
Do you know, it's so true. Snuff out that candle of hope because despair you can live with, but hope is a killer. Never hope.
that really bright moment. We're going to end the podcast. Mama, we love having you on. Thank you so much. Thank you to Emmy Lou as well. Emmy, my sister, thank you for coming on. Listen, please get in touch. Guys, that sounded beggy, but please get in touch. Instagram at NewlyWeds Podcast or email newlyweds@jampopproductions.co.uk, or you can get in touch with us via our secrets hotline. The number is in the description. Leave us a voicemail. We want to hear from you. Congratulations to Emma as well, our winner. That was amazing. Okay, that's the end of the episode. We're going to see you next Monday. Before we go, if you're getting engaged, Mama.
If you're getting engaged, ask for a really good ring.
Okay. If you're getting divorced.
Oh, God, that's the worst. Ring me up. I'll talk you through it.
Okay. If you're thinking, or if you're married.
If you're married, yeah, enjoy.
Okay. And if you're single.
It's all out there, as I said last time. And I will give you one really good word of advice.
Okay.
If you're married and wobbling or thinking about it, I promise you,
yeah,
whatever is out there is not better. It's just different.
Great advice. And remember, don't hope.
No. Give up hope of getting him back.
There you go. That's it. I liked it. All right, everybody. We'll see you next Monday. Goodbye. Bye.